I had had a contractor do a cosmetic remodel on one of the bathrooms. A plumber fixed the leak in the kitchen faucet. I had the floors sanded and stained, the interior painted, and last but not least, I had the back door replaced. It was cracked near the jamb and had been boarded over. Then, after bringing in a crew to clean the place from top to bottom, I got my laptop set up with Wi-Fi and picked up some furniture for the living room and bedroom, as well as a new television for the family room. The original television had rabbit ears antennae and was the size of a treasure chest. Goodwill declined the donation of my grandfather's used furniture, despite my argument that it could be all regarded as antiques, so it ended up at the dump. The porches were in relatively good shape, though, and I spent most of my mornings and evenings there, which is how and why I'd started with the mothballs. Spring in the South isn't only about flowers and honeybees and pretty sunsets, especially when you live adjacent to a creek in what seemed like the wilderness. Because it had been warmer than usual recently, snakes had begun to wake from their winter slumber. I'd spotted a big one on the back porch when I'd wandered outside that morning with my coffee. After having the bejesus scared out of me and spilling half the coffee down the front of my shirt, I quickly ducked back inside the house. I had no idea whether the snake was poisonous or what kind it was. I'm not a snake expert. But unlike some people, my grandfather, for instance, I didn't want to kill it either. I just wanted it to stay away from my house and live over there. I knew that snakes did useful things, like killing mice, which I'd heard scurrying in the walls at night. The sound creeped me out, despite spending every summer here when I was a kid. I'm not used to country living. I'd always considered myself more of a condo in the city guy, which is what I had been, right up until the explosion that blew up not only my entire world, but me as well. Which was why I was convalescing in the first place. But more on that later. For now, though, let's get back to the snake. After changing shirts, I vaguely remembered that my grandfather used mothballs to keep snakes away. He was convinced that mothballs had magic powers to repel all kinds of things, bats, mice, bugs, and snakes, and he would buy the stuff by the case. I'd spotted plenty of them in the barn, and figuring my grandfather must have known something, I seized a box and began to scatter them liberally around the house, first in the back and along the sides, then finally in the front. That was when I again spied the girl trudging down the road that led past the house. She was dressed in jeans and a t-shirt, and when I lifted my gaze, she must have felt my eyes on her because she glanced in my direction. She didn't smile or wave. Instead, she ducked her head as if hoping to avoid acknowledging my presence. I shrugged and went back to work, if dropping mothballs could actually be considered work. For whatever reason, though, I found myself thinking about the trailer park where she lived. It was at the end of the road, about a mile away. Out of curiosity, I'd walked down there shortly after I'd arrived. It had sprung up since the last time I'd visited, and I suppose I wanted to know who the new neighbors were. My first thought upon seeing it was that it made my grandfather's place look like the Taj Mahal. Six or seven ancient and decrepit trailers appeared to have been dropped haphazardly on a dirt lot. In the far corner were the remains of another trailer that had caught fire, leaving only a black, partially melted husk that had never been cleared away. In between the trailers, clotheslines drooped between slanting poles. Scrawny chickens pecked an obstacle course of cars on blocks and rusting appliances, avoiding only a feral pit bull chained to an old discarded bumper. The dog had teeth the size of bacon and barked so ferociously at my presence that spittle flew from its foaming mouth. Not a nice doggy, I remembered thinking. Part of me wondered why anyone would choose to live in a place like this, but then again, I already knew the answer. On my walk back home, I felt pity for the tenants and then chastised myself for being a snob because I knew I'd been luckier than most, at least when it came to money. "Do you live here?" I heard a voice ask. Glancing up, I saw the girl. She doubled back and was standing a few yards away, clearly keeping her distance, but close enough for me to notice a spray of